climate variability and change during the last millennia. It's a pleasure to see so many people here interested in what can be inferred from past climate change during the most recent period. So during this session, we will have an overview of progress in reconstructions and simulations for climates of the last 1,000 years. A new reconstruction of the North Atlantic Oscillation, one of the most important modes of variability at these latitudes. A focus on European summer hydroclimate and the information provided on the longer term than just the instrumental records. And what we can learn from measurements in atmospheric CO2 concentration with respect to climate and land carbon changes during the last 1,000 years. So the first presentation will be given by Fidel González Ruco from Spain, and he has 20 minutes to show you the progress, recent progress in reconstructions and simulations, mostly focusing on temperatures, I think. I will wait 5 minutes before.
Okay, I will need it. Thank you, Valérie, for the very nice introduction. Thank you for the invitation to be here today. Okay, I'll speak closer. Thank you for coming to this session. I would like to introduce today some general ideas about the progress in reconstructions and simulating climate of the last millennium in more or less the last 10, 15 years up to the present IPCC, recent IPCC report. I would like mainly to focus on three different aspects, begin a bit with some introduction, placing a context and trying to answer a little bit the question, why the last millennium? Second, I would like to be able to provide a general idea of how these type of studies have evolved in the last decade. And third, I would like to give you an impression on how model data comparison over the last millennium operates and what type of questions can be answered from it. So to start with, I would like to bring some, to anchor the beginning of the talk in some times well behind, well before the last millennium. This is glacial times. It's a bit of a refreshing image for a summer day. This is a picture of a penguin in a cave, which is called Cosquer Cave, south of France, in this area over here. The penguin is not very visible now, but you can more or less interpolate it from this image here. And this drawing is dated 27,000 years before present. So this gives you an idea that 27,000 years before present, a bit before the last glacial maximum, when Neanderthal was giving way to Homo sapiens, at that time, in order to have this painting, you really needed to have lots of ice in southern France. You needed to have a much lower sea level, because the entrance of this cave is actually about 10 meters below, if I recall correctly, 36 meters below the surface now. And of course, you needed to have penguins, which is a totally different environment than what we can see nowadays. So the changes from the last glaciation to the Holocene, the last 11,000 years, are really large in terms of forcing. The glaciations are produced by changes in orbital forcing that set up the basis for levels of radiation that can really allow for ice to accumulate from one year to the other. And then we have secondary effects. We have feedback effects where temperature and CO2 concentrations couple together and produce a larger temperature change than what we see in the last millennium. The temperature changes that we see in the last millennium are placed here at this end of this plot from chapter 5 of IPCC. This is changes in sea level. This is changes in CO2 here. This is last millennium. This is where we stand now after about 160 years of instrumental period that we will see later. And we will see how in the last millennium the changes in forcing are much smaller, but still there are interesting questions that we can pose and that can serve for the motivation of these sessions. By the way, Thomas, during this session, will be talking actually about coupling between CO2 and temperature changes. This is a much more recent picture. It's a picture from the Four Corners region in the southwest of the United States. This area that has been very rich in buildings and architecture of the Pueblo cultures by the beginning of this millennium, by the end of the first millennium. And these were, of course, cultures that were very much sensitive to drought. They were depending on agriculture. This is a diagram of a drought reconstruction from tree rings in this area and changes in population. Hans will be talking later about hydroclimate and drought. And this is a first image at the beginning of the millennium of important events, mega droughts, that the society was actually very sensitive to. Questions that arise from this are how sensitive are these to external forcing, to internal variability? Can we understand the mechanisms that produce these changes? This is a picture that also reflects more or less the same time period. This time is North Atlantic. Pablo will be talking next about North Atlantic variability. This shows the tracks of migrations from Scandinavia to Iceland, Greenland, and eventually to the north of North America, of the saga of Eric the Red. And this could be done in the 9th and 10th century because the ice conditions in the northern North Atlantic were favorable for navigation. This is a quote, actually taking from Le Roi de la Durie in 71, from his well-known book, where he takes a quote of a Norwegian priest in Greenland in the 14th century, introducing or stating how the conditions in the North Atlantic changed some centuries afterwards and were not favorable for navigation. So the old routes were never again user-friendly. This is a last picture, a last refreshing picture from the Netherlands, a bit later, on what we call now the Little Ice Age, the previous period where the Vikings could navigate in the North Sea. It's generally called in different ways. One of them is the medieval climate anomaly that we refer to it. And this is an image from a typical scene in the Netherlands in the 14th, 15th. This is a painting from the 16th, 17th century, where you could find many of these paintings of activities, feasts, markets, different everyday activities in winter, a picture that is not common anymore of a very well frozen ground during winter. So this image just anchors or tries to anchor what we want to name as the Little Ice Age. And finally, the instrumental period, the last 150 years. This is a plot from IPCC. It was shown this morning. This is temperatures in the last 150 years, basically increasing on the order of about a degree. It's a global increase. We are all more or less familiar with this. It's robust in different data sets, and the last decades have been sequentially the warmest decades of the whole instrumental record. But how does this measured, observed evolution compare with evidences that we have before the instrumental times? And what type of evidence do we have to ask questions and answer questions about the changes in climate before instrumental times? And the answers to that come from the observational side on the hand of the reconstructions and proxy data, and from the side, the alternative side, from the side of model simulations. So I'll go in the next few slides a bit reviewing some ideas around questions and knowledge that comes and has evolved from the side of reconstructions. You will see more later in the subsequent talks. And also, I'll show you some advances in modeling and see how these compare. This is a paper by Osborne and Briefa in 2006. I like to show this picture because actually it makes the proxy data since year 1800 to year 2000 evident. This is IPCC 2007. We have here mostly tree ring data at the time, but also ice cores, coral data. And basically, if you would put all this proxy data together without making any maths on them, just examining the probability distribution of proxy data, they are all temperature sensitive in this case, it comes very evident that medieval times, the time of the Pueblo culture in southwestern USA, or the time of the Vikings in the North Atlantic, were warmer times in the Northern Hemisphere, and then there was a period of colder climate, this so-called Little Ice Age, and then finally the warming of the last 19th and 20th century. So in a very intuitive way, we can see there have been coordinated changes of climate that are consistent in the proxy data. These are not instrumental observations, but they give good information about climate changes through time, climate variability, internal variability, external responses to external forcing. These are the questions. Why these variations? How can we understand them? This is the present distribution of proxy data used for AR5. So you see that there have been significant increases in different parts of the world, but essentially the same picture exists. How has this image evolved through time? So the simplest thing that we can think about is, since we have this proxy data and we have instrumental temperature records in the 20th century, what people do is that they calibrate statistical reconstruction models, and with the statistical reconstruction models, since we have the information from the proxies, which are typically non-dimensional, they have been standardized typically, then you can derive temperature changes for different regions or in the Northern Hemisphere through time back through the last millennium. This has been the typical approach, and this is a plot, the image, the knowledge, essentially condensed in IPCC 2001, where the reconstruction of Manetal was the first, let's say, biggest step in estimating numerically the changes in temperature at the Northern Hemisphere scale through the last millennium. So you see again a warmer period, an almost linear smooth decrease of temperature up to the 19th century, and then the drastic increase of temperature that is also registered in the instrumental data. It's interesting to see that only in year 1990, IPCC was showing a drawing. This was our knowledge of the variability of the last millennium in 1990, a drawing that very much was linked to the knowledge of LAMB. This is the picture of 2007. So I would say from 2001 to 2007, there is one word that makes the change, which is uncertainty. From one point estimation, one case, let's say one case of a reconstruction, a very valuable one, through 10 years of research, 15 years of research, what people have been doing is getting these different reconstruction methodologies, increasing the number of proxies, and picturing the evolution of the last millennium according to the best practices at the time. So we ended up in 2007 having different estimations from different reconstructions. Still, the idea of a warmer medieval climate anomaly was there, a colder Little Ice Age was there, but the degree of changes back in the past, this was uncertain, and still is nowadays in the next picture I'm going to show you. And actually, one can think this is in a very simple way relevant for changing also in future climate change, for thinking, sorry, in future climate change, depending on how large the changes in temperature were through the last millennium, this will have an impact when we compare to models in how we understand and how we assess models for the models that are used for assessing future, for understanding future climate change or for projecting future climate change. So in 2007, this idea of uncertainty, we don't have a point estimation of temperature for every year, but a probability distribution of where temperature more or less stands. That was the step forward in 2007. This is the situation now in IPCC, in the last IPCC in AR5. We have the warming of the instrumental period. We have the Little Ice Age. We have new methods, new reconstructions, a better knowledge of uncertainties. We can actually say that those three decades that were standing as the warmest in the 20th century are very likely the warmest of the last 800 years, and likely the warmest of the last 1400 years. This is where this knowledge stands nowadays at the hemispherical level. What about the simulations? If I would have to anchor a figure for the beginning of the work, not the actual beginning, but a significant step forward in the work of simulating the last millennium, I would select this one of Crowley in year 2000. It's an EVM simulation where Crowley was gathering, he was integrating different forcings that were main players for the last millennium: volcanic activity from different records, solar variability already with uncertainties, and also CO2 and aerosols. And with an EVM, he forced an EVM with boundary conditions provided by these forcings, and this is the result in blue, and checked that basically the long-term trend and much of the low-frequency variability in the last millennium could be linked with the forcing, the external forcing that he was using, and also with the findings here in red in the reconstructions. So it was the first step forward, say we can try to actually explain the responses to external forcing with very simple models. And then after this, many groups came in 10, 15 years' time with a bunch of different forcing selections, different models, producing an ensemble of simulations. This took about 10, 15 years. Through time, different forcing configurations were used. The first forcing configurations that were used for the models as boundary conditions were actually those of Crowley, but with improvements in knowledge and estimations of external forcing, also sometimes changing the paradigm of external forcing reconstructions, like in the case of solar variability. This is the old paradigm that we started with like 15 years ago. Now the PMIP3, CMIP5 simulations are in this range of variability. So this is solar variability, different forcings used by different models, volcanic activity. So you see there's quite a bit of variability. CO2 is quite consistent for different models, greenhouse gases in general. If you put all of them together, you have, again, an envelope of uncertainty to picture the knowledge on forcings of the last millennium. This is also reconstructed from proxy data, but independent from the proxy data that are used to do the temperature reconstructions. So you can see that there is low frequency variability. There is, of course, warming here very much linked to the human activities. There is more higher forcing during the medieval times, and this may be at least partially an explanation for the warmer times during Eric the Red that we saw at the beginning. And there is, of course, a large weight of volcanic activity also on the low frequencies. What do the simulations look like? The gray area behind here, it's the uncertainty I showed before, the spread on the reconstructions of temperature. If we would take an average of all the temperature reconstructions, we would be here in this black line. And if we would consider all the simulations before the actual IPCC report, the AR5, all the simulations would be doing this. So a pretty similar job in qualitative terms. In a first approach, they look very similar. This means that we can explain quite a part of the variability, of the low frequency variability of what was happening in the northern hemisphere, but not all. Some periods pose new questions nowadays. Why forcing and reconstructions are not in agreement here? Why the models are not reproducing this part of the beginning of the first millennium? These are still present questions. But overall, we have made since the last IPCC to the present IPCC, a big step forward in having an ensemble of fully coupled climate models, now Earth system models, that reproduce, overall, looking at it from this distance, a consistent picture with reconstruction. A step forward in the last IPCC was the CMIP5 simulations. I will not go into the details, but I will just say that in the last IPCC, thanks to the CMIP5 model effort and the PMIP3, there was some organization of the external forcing. There was some arrangement of consensus of what people were using to force their models. And there was a new generation of models coming in, and therefore new modeling exercises. So just in the last 2-3 years, we have seen the growth of an ensemble of simulations. You can see it overlapped with the reconstructions in gray. You can see basically two ensembles, in blue with the average and the
and the percentiles, and in red also with the average and the percentiles for the ensemble of PMIP3 runs and the ensemble of simulations previous to the PMIP3 runs. So basically the same idea as before in response to the forcings of the last millennium overall agreement, but not everywhere. You see these large gaps where the reconstructions are still, or the simulations are not still consistent with reconstructions. Overall, we have responses to external forcing. This is volcanic activity. This is a composite analysis with the largest volcanic events, and the response in model simulations being larger than in the reconstructions, for instance. Better agreement in the low frequency. So models are responding and are able to explain at a larger detail the variability that we see in the reconstructions. Also, if we look at the linear relationship between if we look at the relationship between the external forcing and the model response, it's overall very linear along the last millennium. So the linear part of the response is really an important one. We see here for different models correlations between the simulations and the external forcing. High correlations in general, higher than in the reconstructions. The reconstructions also linearly accommodate, not totally, but a good part of the variability is a linear response to the external forcings. Actually, we can place it in the context of climate sensitivity. We have here a representation for different models of different type of climate sensitivity in two in equilibrium experiments, two by CO2, here and here. We have also transient climate sensitivity in this box, represented by simulations of 1% increase into the future, also here. And here in purple, we have simulations of the last millennium and estimates of transient climate response in the last millennium that accommodate well with the fact of having less long-term scale processes accommodating in the evolution of the last millennium, or at least that we give time to the model to accommodate to. Therefore, it's consistent that we get lower numbers for the temperature response in the realistic climate evolution of the last millennium in comparison to future climate change experiments. I'll skip this one. From a more close perspective, closer to the continental scale, we have a very interesting, important effort from the PAGES2K community. We have reconstructions for the different continents, Antarctica, Australasia, South America, North America, Europe here. And these reconstructions span over the last 2K. This is also something new in the last IPCC, that hemispherical reconstructions, the ones that I showed, span really two millennia. And we can compare them with model simulations. The pictures are, again, a bit dark, but you see here the spread of the reconstructions and all the PMIP3 model simulations. And if we just do a simple look at it, we see different regions, different variability in different regions. And we see, for instance, how consistently the different simulations for the different regions accommodate to the variability of every region. If we would go into detail, we would see that, as in the case of the Northern Hemisphere, we have detection of the external forcing signal, natural forcings in the last 1,000 years, and of course, of anthropogenic activities in the last two centuries. This is an example also for the last millennium. This is what you have from the model simulations in the last millennium. This is changes from the medieval climate anomaly to the Little Ice Age. This is changes from present to the medieval climate anomaly, and this is present to the Little Ice Age. So you can see the gradient of temperature changes in the models in simulations with, let's say, higher and solar, different ranges of higher and solar changes in variability. And we have here the reconstructions. I will just go to one or a couple of small issues here. The reconstructions represent a much more richer spatial variability in the past that the models are not bringing in their simulations. And of course, this is an issue that relates to the fact that there is natural variability that is not accounted for by the model simulations, and actually we could argue not even expected to be accounted for by the model simulations. So there's lots of questions that arise from this agreement between proxy reconstructions and simulations, and how we can move forward with it. Last slide. And this is a last slide from these pages to KPMF3 model effort. What you see here is correlations for the different regions, continental regions, on the PMIP3 effort. You can see this range of correlation here. This is how the different continental regions correlate among each other in this range. And this is, if you take all the models, the different models of the PMIP3, how do the models, when you consider those specific regions, correlate? How do the temperatures from these simulated regions correlate among each other? And you see that some of the models range down to the same levels that you have in the reconstructions, but all of them also show larger correlations in the consistency, in the agreement between these regions that you can find in the reconstructions. And actually, some of the models really show very high correlations in comparison to the reconstructions, which is an issue. Models see a much more homogeneous picture than what we see in the reconstructions. And if this is too homogeneous in comparison to reconstructions, we will have the same issue also in future climate change experiments. I leave you with the conclusions.
Thank you very much, Fidel, for this very comprehensive overview of progress through time. So for those who have arrived in the meanwhile, and for those who were here before the start of the talk, let me explain you the rules. There will be no question and answers after each of the presentations, so please write them down, keep them in memory, and after the next three shorter presentations, we will have a session of question and answers during about half an hour, so that you can exchange with the whole panel. So the next presentation will be given by Pablo Ortega from the UK, and he will show a reconstruction of the North Atlantic Oscillation in winter during the last 1,000 years. Pablo? You have a pointer, and you have to speak here.
Thank you, Valerie. I'm really glad to be here, especially on behalf of my co-authors, and to present this work that we just recently published. And also happy that Fidel gave his introductory talk. I'm going to give a particular example of how you can use models to improve the reconstructions. It's a particular case of what Fidel explained before. I'm going to change the, I hope you can hear me at the back. I'll try to talk louder. So I'm going to focus on the North Atlantic region. I'm going to be talking about the North Atlantic Oscillation. So first things first, I'm going to tell you what it is. The North Atlantic Oscillation is a pattern of atmospheric circulation in the North Atlantic that dominates the variability of sea level pressures from daily to multi-decadal time scale. It's associated with this particular special pattern. You can see here a dipole of sea level pressure anomalies with positive values at mid-latitudes and negative values over more polar latitudes. And the main thing here is that it's important for climate because it's controlling the direction of the storms that arrive to Europe. Indeed, to track its variability in time, we usually define an index that is measuring the difference in pressures between Azores and Iceland. That would be this index here. When the index is positive, we say that we are in a positive NEO phase. And in this particular case, we have the storms that are directed more into Northern Europe and Central Europe. They bring precipitation, and they are also gonna bring warmer temperatures because the storms are coming from mid-latitudes in the Atlantic. And what we're gonna have at the same time is that the Mediterranean sector is gonna stay on the dry side. Something opposite happens when we are in a negative phase. In this particular case, the dipole is going to be weaker than normal, and the storms are going to be directed towards the Mediterranean sector, bringing precipitation there. There are many climate impacts of the NAO, and they are not restricted to Europe. You can see here, for example, correlations between the NAO with winter precipitation and winter temperature. This is era interim. And I'm just gonna point out, for example, that we have strong negative correlation with Greenland in terms of temperature, and also for all Eurasia and the western part of North America. Thanks to these climate impacts, we can be able to reconstruct the variability of the NAO back in time. There are natural archives that are sensitive to these climate variations, and they're going to be able to tell us what could have happened in the past with the NAO. Indeed, there is already one reconstruction that is available since 2009 by Truet et al. Here. They used two particular proxies, one from Scotland related to precipitation, and one from Morocco that was a drought severity index. By combining them, they could see that there was a period in medieval times coinciding with the medieval climate anomaly that was particularly warm, in which the NAO was persistently positive. And this is something that they really, really stress, because they propose that it could have contributed in a way, dynamically, to the particular magnitude of the medieval warm period, Little Ice Age transition. This result in itself was really important at the time. The problem is that when you look at other archives, they don't all support it. So I'm coming back now to the changes in temperature. I'm pointing here to Greenland. These correlations are about 0.7. And if you go there, Greenland is a region in which we have a lot of proxy data, and look at proxies for temperature, what you would expect if the medieval period was particularly had a positive NAO, since the correlation is negative, you would expect really negative anomalies in temperature. But that's not what you see, indeed. These are records from two particular sites, from boreholes and also from water-stable isotopes. And in all cases, what you see is that the anomalies, if anything, were positive. That means that if anything, they would suggest that the NAO was negative. And here we have a really big discrepancy. If we want to know what was the evolution of the NAO and also its role in climate, and we look at different proxies and they disagree, that's not the good starting point. Can we actually say something? Well, we have tried to do that, and that's what our article it's about. There are two reasons that I'm going to talk about that could explain the discrepancy. The first is that proxies sometimes have non-climatic signals that are local and that could affect the long-term trends. And that could explain why one search supporting one kind of variability and the others don't. The other issue is a bit more subtle. The NAO and its structure is not stable in time. It might change. It has shifted in the past. And when it shifts, the particular climate impacts change. So regions that are sensitive, for example, nowadays, maybe 500 years ago, were not reflecting changes in the NAO. Those are two big issues that are not easy to deal with, but that should be at least minimized if we want to reconstruct the NAO. For the first, what is usually done in the paleo community is multi-proxy approaches. If you combine more proxies from different regions and for different types, it's easier when you combine and look at the common signal that the non-climatic signals cancel out with each other, and that what you get is more representative of the NAO in our case. This picture here is showing that we have been able to identify 48 proxies that could work to reconstruct the NAO. All of them correlate in the overlap period with the observations with the NAO. So in principle, it's something that we could use. And with 48 proxies, it would be easier to produce a robust reconstruction. The problem is that if you go now to think of the second issue, that is the non-stationarity of the teleconnections, then most probably many of these proxies won't be as good. That's something that you cannot know per se, but that you can try to assess with models. And this is where we make use of models. As Fidel showed, there are already a lot of simulations that have been done with the best knowledge of the forcing and that covered the last millennium. We took then, we defined proxies that were pseudo proxies that were mimicking our proxies, and we looked at the relationship with the NAO. If they were significant for the whole extent of the simulation, we would keep them because we would be more confident that they were representing a stable teleconnection. I'm gonna jump now into the reconstruction, but first I just wanna say that we haven't done one, we have done an ensemble of reconstructions. We have considered different calibration period, leaving therefore different periods for validation also. And this is what we have. You can see here in full colors that only 9 of the 48 initial proxies remain. None still enough, in principle, at least better than the two that Trué had used. And when you compare the time series, what you do see is that there is a nuance in what our reconstruction suggests. We don't see no longer a persistent positive NAO phase, but we do see that there was a period, there were the 13th and 14th century that had more positive values of the NAO. The mean over those centuries was significantly different than zero. We have also assessed to what extent the using the models to constrain the proxy selection was useful. So here in yellow we have correlations for an alternative reconstruction, and we would take the 48 proxies. And in purple, this reconstruction that is model constrained. Comparing the correlations for the ensemble in the calibration period gives similar scores, but when you go down to the validation period that is independent, you do see that there is an improvement for our model constrained reconstruction, which means that this information is being really useful to improve the quality of the reconstruction. There is something else we can do with models. 2 minutes, okay, I'll go fast. Two slides. Something else that we can do, you can use them as a surrogate reality in which you can assess different reconstruction techniques. You define pseudo proxies, with then you mimic the reconstruction and you produce pseudo reconstructions, and then you compare that with the simulated variability in the models. You can do it for the by-proxy definition of Trué, and you can do it as well for our multi-proxy reconstruction. Here we show a PDF of the 50-year sliding correlation between the pseudo reconstruction and the simulated variability, and what you can see here is that for Trué, there are periods in which the correlations are really close to zero and even negative, supporting that this the correlations with the NAO had not been stable in time, at least for those proxies. When you consider all together, there is a clear improvement. We still have periods that were not so good, but in general, they all stay positive, and the median is clearly higher, and this is for all the models. So with this, what I want to stress is that our reconstruction is probably more robust, at least according to the models. And I'm going to conclude with this other slide that I've included just to show what we can learn by producing reconstructions. We have looked at the impact of the forcings of both solar and volcanoes, and for the particular case of volcanoes, what we have seen is that for the strongest volcanoes, there is a dynamic response of the NAO. 2 years after, the NAO becomes positive here, and this is a threshold of 95% confidence, significance. This kind of response with the NAO being almost systematically positive had been previously observed for Pinatubo with satellite data, but this is the first time that had been seen over such a small, such a big sample of events. Thanks to the reconstruction that is covering the whole millennium, you can check at the impact of other events that are not included in the observations and confirm this kind of response. And since I already met the time, I leave you with the conclusions. And thank you very much.
So again, please note your questions if you have any, and we will take them at the end of the presentations. So the next talk will be given by Hans Linderholm from Sweden, and this time he will extend the focus not only on temperature, but on hydroclimate variability in European summer.
Thank you, Valerie, and thank you to the organizers for inviting me here. And now I will go to something different and maybe something more complicated when it comes to reconstructing. I will talk about summer hydroclimate variability in Europe, focusing on Fennoscandia, but also touch a bit upon the rest of Europe. And connecting this to what Fidel talked about previously, this is also something that is done within this PAGES 2K effort, where it's not only temperature that is the concern, reconstructing temperature over the past 2,000 years, but also looking into hydroclimate variability across the world. Okay, so first of all, I have a short motivation why we want to reconstruct hydroclimate patterns back in time. And then, as I said, I will focus on Fennoscandia and also touch briefly upon Europe and then summarize everything. Okay, so for those of you who attended the session this morning, you have realized that hydroclimate variability is a really important issue in the future, where the expected future looks like the drier areas will become more drier and the wetter areas may become more wetter. But there is a problem in kind of quantifying these changes in the future, mainly because we know quite little about hydroclimate variability in the past. And in order to understand natural hydroclimate variability, we have to extend the records, of course, back in time, which is, of course, not easy. So there still exists quite substantial knowledge gaps about this kind of variability back in time, as opposed to temperature. And Fidel showed some very nice overview of temperature reconstructions and so on. But when it comes to precipitation, we have many, many very local reconstructions, but going on regional scale is more difficult. However, there have been some efforts using tree ring data to reconstruct summer hydroclimate variability in North America, the North American Drought Atlas, which was published by Ed Cook et al. In 2004, and more recently, the Monsoon Asia Drought Atlas. So these reconstruct summer hydroclimate variability using tree ring data. Okay, so two regions covered. So then, of course, Europe would be the next place to go to. So the aim of this, the first study I'm going to present, which is just recently published in Climate Dynamics, it's about trying to reconstruct drought variability or hydroclimate variability in Fennoscandia, which is a region where which you really don't connect with severe droughts. Maybe very wet conditions, but not really severe droughts. The target was the gridded standardized precipitation and evapotranspiration index, SPEI. And you see it's quite a dense gridded data set that exists. And we were using 104 tree ring chronologies from this region to reconstruct this. So basically what we wanted to do was to use the tree ring data and reconstruct each and every one of these grid points as far back in time as we could. Now you realize that you will need to use some of these tree ring chronologies for many of these grid points in order to success with this. And actually what we did was to have kind of a search radius of 210 kilometers around each grid point, testing those tree ring chronologies that were close by to see if they could be used to reconstruct hydroclimate. And as you will see, we couldn't actually manage to reconstruct all of these more than 1,300 grid points. Anyway, so this method is called point-by-point regression. So basically, you make a regression model for each single grid point, then you average them together. And the good thing about this is it's you don't only get a very nice wiggly line that you can show, which I actually will show in a moment. But the thing is that you can produce annual maps of hydroclimate conditions, in our case, for the last 1,000 years, which, of course, are very useful. Here's the wiggly line. Okay, so this is the main result of summer drought or summer hydroclimate variability in Fennoscandia for the last 1,000 years. And you will see that the uncertainty increases going back in time because we have fewer and fewer very long chronologies, especially from the southern parts of Fennoscandia. Basically, we do quite a good job estimating observed SPEI. And what you can say about this long term is that, well, first of all, we don't have very large low frequency variability, and that is because how we process the data before running them into the model. What you can say that here, dry conditions are negative and wet conditions are positive. So maybe you could say that the medieval climate anomaly was in general a bit drier, and then going into the Little Ice Age, maybe a bit wetter. But we see that we have some nice variability, and this is an average for the whole region, of course. Going into the 20th century, we see actually maybe it's becoming slightly drier. But no clear tendencies, no clear trends. But we see that we have some periods that are more quiet and some periods where we have very large variability from wet periods to dry periods and so on. And this, of course, have had impact on societies. We can break it down into different regions. And here, this figure shows the length of the reconstructions for the different regions, and you see that they differ because of the difference in length of the chronologies used. Anyway, we can go into different regions, and we can note that we have some really dry periods and some really wet periods, and that they don't coincide. So even in a relatively small region as Fennoscandia, the hydroclimate variability during summer differs quite a lot throughout the last 1,000 years. The longest continuous dry or wet periods that were found were about a little more than 10 years. So we don't really have these extended mega droughts in our record at least. What you can see is that the westernmost regions, 1, 3, and 4 in this figure, they have some kind of consistent patterns, and it seems that the 17th century was the driest, with frequent drought episodes that were found in this period. And the reason why I put arrows here is that I want you to remember them until a couple of slides ahead. The interesting thing is that we can go on, because we have, even though it's not as good as in continental Europe, we do have some nice records of famine and so on occurring, and many of these events actually coincide with bad harvests and famine and so on. So that's the way. The good thing when having these kind of gridded products is that we can start doing some analysis on this. And this is doing a principal component on the drought or the hydroclimate variability on the observation and on the reconstruction. And you see that we have different patterns that are dominating. So the most common pattern explaining almost 50% of the variance is kind of a whole regional drought, where at least most of Sweden and parts of Finland, they have dry conditions or wet conditions. And the other mode is kind of dry south, wet north, and vice versa. And the good thing is that, of course, we capture these patterns in the reconstruction. And we also can see, going back in time, that these patterns seem to be consistent. We have these two major modes of drought variability. And then we can have a look at what these could be associated with. In this context, we look at the atmospheric circulation. And you all heard in the morning about the importance of the atmospheric circulation, and Pablo also told you about the wintertime circulation, the North Atlantic Oscillation. What we see is that the whole regional drought is associated with this high pressure that is kind of stationed right across Fennoscandia, which is associated with the Scandinavian pattern, yielding these very dry conditions in most of this area. When it comes to this north-south pattern, it's actually more related to the summer North Atlantic Oscillation pattern, which is actually similar to what Pablo showed, but it's shifted a bit to the north. So instead of the Azores and Iceland, the action centers are actually over UK, Fennoscandia, and Greenland. So then we have some kind of idea of what's behind these drought patterns. And this will, of course, make the possibilities to look how this has shifted in time. And again, using independent reconstructions of the circulation, we can say that these patterns seem stable in time as well. Okay. So I will quickly now turn to something that is in the pipeline. And now in the beginning I told you that Ed Cook had produced two drought atlases for North America and for monsoon Asia. That now, soon, the next thing will be showcased, and it's the old world drought atlas. And the old world is consisting of Europe, the Middle East, and also North Africa. And it's kind of the same idea here, lots of tree ring chronologies, this time only those extending over the last 1200 years or longer are used. And instead of the SPEI, it's the self-calibrated PDSI that is used. Lots of grid points, lots of tree ring data. And since this is results that are in review, I will only show you one slide. Just kind of a teaser. But the thing is, this is what we can make with this kind of data, with the tree ring data. This is just showing composites of very dry years in the 17th century, in which is known for very dry conditions in central England and Wales. So these dates have been noted in literature as being very dry. So this is what the Old World Drought Atlas says. This is what the tree ring says. So basically, this is taking those with more than 95% confidence levels. And you see that indeed you have very dry, which is the brown conditions over southern UK and including Wales, also in Fennoscandia. And actually, when I had these arrows done in some previous slides, they correspond to these dry conditions in the 17th century. Again, this is kind of related to this, to the positive summer NAO, I would assume. But the good thing is that you can go from year to year and have a look at how drought, or pluvials for that matter, how they have evolved. The different regions that have been affected, are they covering most of Europe? Are they very local? Or do they shift in different ways? And that will tell us much more about the mechanisms about past changes and variability in the hydroclimate many hundreds of years back in time. Okay, so I think I'm on time. So just to sum up, this is a fantastic product. You can actually use this and go in, you can zoom into certain grid points, and you can get timelines, you can get maps, and this will be excellent to compare with the climate models, to see the spatial relationships and so on, but also to compare with forces like the atmospheric circulation and ocean variability and so on. So, thank you very much.
So as you have seen, we have organized this session going from the large scale temperature to the new information emerging at the regional scale, also for hydroclimate. And now let's go back again at the global scale, looking at the atmospheric concentration of CO2 and climate relationships. So Thomas Pauska is going to make this presentation. He's now in the UK. And I'm just preparing your slides.
Okay. Thank you, Valerie, and thanks for the conveners for inviting me to give this talk here. So we're going to switch gears a bit from temperature to the carbon cycle, and I'll be talking about showing some ice core evidence that can disentangle what the possible sources and sinks for CO2 were prior to the Industrial Revolution. And I'd like to acknowledge funding from the NSF and my time at Oregon State University, where I completed this, as well as some collaborators at the University of Bern, primarily Fortunatios. A couple times in the early sessions, we've seen the atmospheric CO2 record from ice cores. Here I'm showing you just a small snippet of the larger, 800,000-year CO2 record, covering the last 1,000 years from the Waste Divide ice core. And at this point in the stage in the ice core community, we're kind of zooming into the fine details with the drilling of high accumulation cores like Waste Divide, and prior to that, a record at Loch Dome by the Australians. But as soon as these small CO2 variations were observed, a debate began about what the actual drivers of the CO2 were. One theory was that climate was driving the changes in CO2, and to introduce that, I'll discuss climate carbon feedbacks in the system. So just for reference here, we have our CO2 record, and then one of the many temperature reconstructions that are out there. I'm just showing the Northern Hemisphere reconstruction from Mann et al. To put this in some context, though, let's think about what's happening today. Presently, CO2 is increasing from fossil fuel emissions and temperature is increasing. But because temperature is increasing, it's been hypothesized that CO2 itself will increase via natural climate carbon feedbacks, which will then in turn drive CO2, drive temperature higher. And the main theory for this is that increased temperatures increase the rate of respiration of carbon in the soils, driving CO2, CO2 flux to the atmosphere. So to put this in some context, this is from the fourth assessment, not the fifth assessment. I need to update this slide. But color-coded the same way here are actually model runs with driven by initially one emission scenario here in black, and they're allowed to have their climate carbon feedbacks freely evolve. And so this is their predicted CO2 levels, therefore, you know, greatly increasing the temperature, eventual temperature uncertainty in projections over the next 100 years. So one idea has been to disentangle this is to look back into the natural past where perhaps temperature was driving the changes in CO2 to understand this feedback. But we can't totally eliminate anthropogenic effects even in the past because the second theory for what was driving CO2 was anthropogenic land use change. But there's a large amount of uncertainty when it comes to this. So to orientate you here again, we have our CO2. What I'm showing here on the in the middle panel is model predictions for changes in organic land carbon stocks driven by land use change models with different assumptions for population, which I'm just showing a little kind of schematic of world population here. So what you see, if you look at the purple line, some models predict very slight losses of land carbon over the last 1,000 years prior to the Industrial Revolution. This cuts off at 1850, of about, say, 32 gigatons of carbon per 1,000 years, with obviously an acceleration around 1800. Other models, that, particularly those that depend, that have different assumptions about population to land use change, show a higher sensitivity in the land use change response. That's an example here of a red line here. So higher sensitivity both for the overall increase, you see this acceleration here, and they also simulated multi-decadal scale variability, which looks somewhat similar to the record, the variability we see in the atmospheric CO2 record. This is driven by things, for example, here in the 10th and 11th century rising population in China, the drop here in CO2 has been hypothesized to be driven by widespread pandemics in the New World following post-Columbian contact and regrowth of the biosphere. So, but at the moment, we didn't really know what the ultimate drivers of CO2 were. So we wanted to ask this question using the carbon isotopes of CO2. And for this, the purpose of this talk, I think the main thing to remember is that there's two fractionations or two processes that differentiate the carbon isotopes and the CO2 that we'll take advantage of. One is that if you were to increase ocean temperature, you would cause a flux of CO2 out of the atmosphere because it would be less soluble in seawater. And that will change the magnitude of fractionation across the air-sea gas interface, so we'll increase C13. So if sea surface temperatures were driving the CO2 changes, if we were to plot delta C13, the stable isotopes of CO2, versus CO2, we'd see a positive relationship. Now there's a second fractionation we can take advantage of, and that's during photosynthesis. So photosynthesis takes up lighter carbon onto land or when it's exported to the deep ocean. So say we had a decrease in biological carbon storage, a flux of carbon from the land to the atmosphere, CO2 is increased, C13 would become more negative. So in that case, in our plot of C13 versus CO2, we'd see a negative correlation. So what is the data say? This is the waste divide record here in red. We have CO2, C13 concentrated on the upper two panels here. The gray data would be the previous records from La Dome, and the time scale here is about 1750 to 1930 is when our record stops. So the main take home is that this waste divide record provided really unprecedented resolution and precision for the C13, then it's quite obvious that the CO2 and C13 prior to the Industrial Revolution are negatively covarying. So that suggests a negative delta C13 reservoir as controlling the atmosphere. So if we go back to our cross plot of C13 versus CO2, we can look at the data here in red. And we see that it's organic carbon driving the atmospheric CO2. We could take it a step further because of this, the precision and resolution of the data. We're able to put the two histories of CO2 and C13 into a very simple carbon cycle model, essentially just a box model. But then we were able to deconvolve the land and ocean atmospheric history. So I won't go into the details, but essentially, you know, take two unknowns, or say take two knowns and put them into a model, you get two unknowns with some assumptions, some fairly simple assumptions about changes in sea surface temperature. So then we can add to our story about what was driving atmospheric CO2. So plotted, I've returned here to our model predictions for anthropogenic land use change. And now we have a constraint on the total organic carbon budget here. That's in green with a degree of uncertainty. So what do we see? Also, just to reorientate you, up would be sinks for CO2, and then down would be, you know, net sources of CO2. So overall, we see an uptake of carbon across the last millennium. And then comparing that then essentially to the two model predictions, first say, if looking at the purple line, if anthropogenic emissions are rather modest, then the difference between these two curves would imply a rather modest natural carbon sink of about 60 gigatons of carbon per 1,000 years. And that's generally in line with other model predictions of peatland regrowth. Now, what if anthropogenic emissions are rather high, looking at the red curve? Well, first, the divergence is larger, so it implies a much larger natural land carbon sink of almost 120 gigatons of carbon per 1,000 years. But then, interestingly, because it's sensitive to the multi-decadal scale, it can explain some of the variations we see on the shorter time scales. So, one question we can ask then is, if these high anthropogenic emissions are consistent, then we need to look for a sort of unknown large land carbon sink. Alternatively, we can say anthropogenic changes are rather modest, and we're looking for a natural feedback that's driving the multi-decadal scale variability. So that was the second thing we'll turn to now. We've heard a lot about the climate reconstructions over the last millennium already, so I won't go into the detail too much. But essentially, what we did was just wanted to do a simple statistical analysis and try to figure out, to fingerprint where the possible temperature land carbon feedback could be acting. So we took the PAGES 2K regional reconstructions, put them into a multiple linear regression model. All we're really doing is looking for the highest correlation, what can best explain the data. So, and that what came out of that was that Arctic temperature explained the most variability, and secondarily, some reconstructions of tropical temperature seemed to correlate. I'll blow it up, the Arctic temperature, on the next slide here, but in the green again is our land carbon changes. I've flipped the axis though here to show the correlation. Red is Arctic temperature. This is a reconstruction of African lake temperature from Lake Tanganyika. So unfortunately though, I think at the moment, we've heard a little bit about it already, but the temperature reconstructions in the tropics are perhaps too uncertain. So let's speculate mostly about this Arctic temperature feedback just to finish up here. So I've blown up the data here again. We have both our reconstructed changes in land carbon in green and just the raw data too, just to show you in red here, delta C13, also flipped to show possible correlations. So then this is the PAGES 2K changes in Arctic temperature. Now, it's definitely not one-to-one, but I think what it may be hinting at is that periods of elevated Arctic temperature show periods of enhanced land carbon flux to the atmosphere. So sources of carbon to the atmosphere when Arctic temperature is high. And from there, we can't fingerprint it any further. This is a fairly speculative analysis. But there are a lot of ecosystems that I think require further study. This data might suggest that. So boreal forests, soil respiration, and boreal forests are a source. Permafrost has been hypothesized to be a source of carbon in elevated temperatures, and also peatland sources of carbon that could during periods of elevated temperature. Oh, that's really blue. Anyway, so just to conclude up here, we've extended these observations of the carbon isotopes of CO2 with really unprecedented precision and resolution. I hope I've demonstrated that pre-industrial CO2 was largely driven by land carbon sinks and sources. We've constrained the total organic carbon budget, and we haven't been able to conclude that either it's all anthropogenic or all natural climate variability, but we've put very strict limitations on the balance between the two. So someone can put out a model and say anthropogenic land use changes are X. Now we can take the total and say, well, then natural variations must be Y. And then lastly, I just think that the data present a really challenging benchmark now for models that are both simulating climate. So we've seen the challenge and the potential for using paleo data for temperature reconstructions. I think we could add a factor to this and say that the models that use carbon cycles feedbacks should also use this ice core data as a target. And then overall, I just hope that to say that the bubbles that are captured in the ice core tell us a lot about the past and maybe just a little bit about the future. So, okay. Thanks.
So now I suggest that all the presenters come back on stage and we can allow a little more than 20 minutes for questions. So please raise your hands if you have a question. And I think there's a light you can activate in front of your microphone so that we can hear you. Alan?
Yes, I wanted to ask a question about the NAO 2 years after large volcanic eruptions, a positive NAO, but not 1 year after. That goes against all our understanding of the volcanic response, the atmospheric response to volcanic eruptions. Can you explain why there would not be a response 1 year, but only 2 years after?
Hello, we was coming there just to be able to see.
It's just in front of you.
Hello. We haven't digged really into the real mechanism that is behind, but we believe that it has to do with some kind of response to the uneven warming, uneven cooling that you have in the ocean between tropical and northern latitudes.
Well, I mean, that's not what climate models show when you put a large volcanic eruption in. So is it maybe a question of the dating that you're using for the time of the eruption and the time of the response?
It could be. That's something that we have really checked and double-checked. I was showing in the picture, there were a lot of lines. I didn't have time to stop and tell the details, but we considered three different reconstructions for volcanic eruptions. We checked which events were consistent with the three of them, and then we looked at historical evidence that would tell us which was the actual year of the reconstruction. So we did our best to be able to pick the exact year. could be something related to the fact that the atmosphere takes some time just to respond, and also to the fact that the first the dating could also had some problems. Yes. At the beginning, we could see a response for the three first years, and it's just when we refined the selection, when we double checked the dates, and we were more restrictive, that we found it was only significant the second year.
There was another question, I think, here. Yes.
Yeah, it's also for Pablo and probably to some others, probably Fidel. I'm really glad with the reconstruction of NAO, but of course, and it shows like a big improvement from TrueA et al. But NAO explains about a third of SLP variability in the winter northern hemisphere. Mm-hmm. And although very important to precipitation and temperature in Europe and some parts of North America, there are other modes, like we've seen Scandinavian, Eastern Atlantic, that are so important. Is it feasible to use the same proxies to reconstruct those other two very important modes?
I do think so, that you can. You just need to be sure. We did a previous analysis using only ice core data from Greenland. We were able to see that there were different imprints for the four major wind regimes. We would look at the daily time scale, and we would see the changes in frequency of occurrence over the instrumental period, and compared with the ice core data. We used about 20 different ice cores, and we could see different imprints. So you would expect doing something like that to identify different patterns of response that could let you produce different reconstructions.
I think also one limitation is the availability of records that are sensitive to what's happening in winter. And for instance, Hans, you showed what's feasible with the tree-ring records from Scandinavia, and are more sensitive to summer climate. So here you have a limitation depending on what each proxy record is resolving in terms of seasonal signals as well. Fidel?
Yeah, just a brief comment. I would like to remark there. Yeah, I would like to remark the potential of the PEMIP 3 data set there. Because actually what Pablo and the co-authors did, they evaluated first the potential of reconstructing NAO in the simulated climate, and then applied the conclusions from that in a successful way to obtain a reconstruction of the NAO from actual proxy data. So answering one answer to your question about the feasibility of doing it would come from a methodological standpoint. Can it be, if we would have good quality proxy data, that we would reconstruct it? Would we be able to do that? And there is a real large ensemble of model runs that are really valuable now that would help better than a few years ago to evaluate the answer to that question. So you can really play around with the simulations and see also, you know, different groups can do that using the data that are publicly available.
Another question? Raise your hand so that I can see you. Where?
In back.
Oh, okay. Yes, sir.
My question regards the last presentation. I'm just curious about knowing the increasement of the concentration of carbon dioxide, the atmospheric carbon dioxide. Are we able to measure this increasement, for instance, saying 10% every 10 years or something? Because to best of my knowledge now, the ambient concentration of carbon dioxide, it's plus or minus 400.
So I think the question was about monitoring the most recent change in CO2 concentration.
Yeah, what we're doing with the the ice core is completely different than the actual monitoring of modern measurements, where you can have, you know, regional variability and seasonal variability. In the ice core, actually, as the gases are trapped in the ice, they're slightly smooth, so we won't see seasonal signals of that magnitude or the regional variability. We only have the Antarctic record, actually. But that's good enough for the purposes of sort of like the modeling and large scale things I'm talking about there, because it's fairly well mixed over the time periods we were measuring on, you know, multiple decades. So
maybe to complement, there is a session later today at UPMC about monitoring greenhouse gases and the methods that are deployed using coordinated international networks for present-day greenhouse gas data. Any other question? Okay, I have a question for you. How do you think we can use information from the last 1,000 years to better inform, let's say, policymakers for adaptation? Because you showed, all of you, information about natural variability. You challenged, explicitly or implicitly, the ability of climate models to resolve this natural variability, or the coherency, the spatial coherency of results. So how do you think we can make use of this long-term information to be better prepared for what's going to happen in the future?
Okay, I'll have a first take on Valerie's question. I would say that, can you hear me? Yeah. I would say that there are several examples, and quite a large number of examples can be brought to the table showing how analyzing the climate of the last millennia can help in identifying deficiencies or limitations, or I would rather say areas where the models can be improved. These are the tools that are actually used to project future climate, and this would be one way, being better informed with better tools and evaluating these tools in a period of time that is not the actual period of time that is used to produce the model parameterizations, to really construct the models. So that would be one first sentence to contribute to the audience.
Yeah, I also think that most of you have surely heard about this warming hiatus, which many, let's say, more skeptical people would say that, well, there's a proof that the global warming has stopped. And I think that understanding how these kind of slowdowns, if it's so, how if they are caused by natural variability, I think that's quite very useful to really stress that even though we may have this very steep increase in temperatures, we'll always have this natural variability. And if we can show that with our paleoclimate records, I think that that will be a good way to convince some people at least.
Yes, sir.
So I have a sort of related question. In the discussion of the comparison of the paleoclimate reconstructions for the last millennium for essentially the Northern Hemisphere and the model comparison, you demonstrated that in fact the models appear to be too coherent in their temperature responses relative to the observations, which would suggest that maybe the models underestimate the internal variability of the climate system. If they underestimate the internal variability, first part is why? Is it land processes, ocean processes, or paleoclimate data? And secondly, if the models underestimate the natural variability, how can we have so much confidence in their future projections?
Yeah, that's a nice one to discuss about. Yeah, that would be my take on it. I think that there is a potential underestimation of internal variability. I think this is not so dramatic at the global hemispherical scale, where we see there is quite a good agreement. So the agreement can be discussed for different time periods and time scales. There we don't have indications of a large underestimation of internal variability that could somehow make the results of the model simulations weak in terms of representing the responses to the forcing. But when you go to the more regional spatial scales, this is where internal variability is more dominant. It plays a larger role. Depending on the spatial scale, it gets more and more comparable to the response to the external forcing. I'm talking temperature, I'm not talking hydroclimate. Then internal variability is even more important. And I think there are different results for different regions, like for instance Europe, where there are good signs of an underestimation of internal variability. Why? There can be different reasons that account for this. One possible reason is that models, of course, they don't capture all potential mechanisms. They are very evolved in comparison to a couple of decades ago, but they are limited representations of reality. So many of the real features that you would like possibly nowadays to have included in the models in a comprehensive or more realistic way, they're still not there. This does not invalidate their use for the main purpose, for analyzing climate change and things at the global hemispherical scale, and it gets interesting when you go regional and continental. So one thing is about the mechanisms, and also interactions between different parts of the systems. For instance, potential responses, amplification responses to solar variability, the responses to volcanic activity. There's many processes that are not yet well accounted for. They contribute to the uncertainty, and they also may contribute to internal variability. I don't know if the response is too general. We can get a bit more into details if appropriate.
I should just add that I agree with almost everything you've said, except that for the Southern Hemisphere and the Northern Hemisphere, actually the models also show too much coherence relative to paleoclimate reconstructions for the whole of the Southern Hemisphere versus the whole of the Northern Hemisphere. And we think it's ocean variability that isn't adequately represented in the climate models. And I'm referring to a paper by Neukum et al. Last year, and I'm one of the owls.
Me too. I was just about to bring that one, but that's a good point. Thank you.
Any other question? Yes?
Is one of the problems that we do not have, in fact, a good comprehensive collection of all the data that exist in the world? I'm thinking of analog bits of scrappy paper in heaps and that sort of thing. So the challenge then is how to get hold of absolutely everything, because you cannot do better than to try to drive your models from all the data you can possibly have.
Who's willing to? So the question was about using all existing information in order to improve the comparison with model results.
Yeah, and it's getting hold of that information in digital form.
I mean, that has been clearly one of the goals of the PAGES 2K initiative, having groups working together and standardizing the digital storage of all data that are available on the PAGES 2K website. It has already been done for temperature with a gap for Africa. It's ongoing for hydroclimate at the moment. And that's clearly a very important aspect of progressing on the data side. I think there are also ideas of data assimilation that can be used in order to better understand potentially the mechanisms at play. But maybe some of you would like to answer, maybe Hans?
Yes. No, I agree. I mean, that's the goal, of course, to collect as much of the existing data as possible. That goes for observations as well. And I mean, one thing that is really difficult when it comes to looking at precipitation patterns and trying to get this large scale analysis is that there is a lack of precipitation data. Different precipitation data sets says different things. And since precipitation is so variable spatially, there, of course, is a large need of good data coverage in order to fully understand how precipitation variability or hydroclimate variability actually looks like in the observational period. So, yeah, I totally agree with that.
I think there was another question as well. Who was waiting for asking a question? No? No other question at the moment? So we are just perfectly on time. I would like to thank, on behalf of Gabby Hegel, my co-convener, and myself, I would like to thank all the speakers for accepting our invitations. And thank you for attending this session.